aim is not necessarily to find the fittest person. The aim is to find the CrossFit Games champion.
Immersive sports science content, not commentary, sports science and not bro science. And in this video, we'll be reviewing the science behind the documentary, The Fittest, which is a Buttery Bros documentary about the 2019 CrossFit Games. Now, for many people who don't quite know what CrossFit is, they may just see it as an opportunity for gym bros to show up without shirts on. And that's just the women.
Seriously, bunch of show-offs. To be fair though, if you have got it, flaunt it. By the way, that's not advice from me, nor is that sports science or scientific in any way.
So what actually is CrossFit?
I don't even know what that means.
No one knows what it means, but it's provocative. It gets the people going.
CrossFit is a company and a sport set up by Greg Glassman. Now, he's quite a controversial character, mainly for whatever this was meant to mean.
What are you going on about, you dipstick?
And for the perceived way he treats his affiliates and gym owners. But more about how his controversial ownership affects the 2019 CrossFit Games later.
CrossFit is functional movements constantly varied at high intensity. So to break that down, functional movements. Movements that you do every day in life. Squatting to sit down in your chair, deadlifting to pick stuff up off the ground, pressing stuff overhead to put it in the pantry.
And so the concept of functional fitness has been massacred. This term functional training is such an umbrella term. So many different training applications can fall under this term functional training. And so if you hear people say, this is functional training and this is not functional, that is just, in many cases, disingenuous, and these people generally don't understand the breadth of what functional training can mean. And so within mainstream fitness and YouTube fitness, the functional training I see, I would actually categorize as movement training. Alternative pieces of equipment which are heavily movement based, which have direct applications to sport, athletic performance, or daily activity. And most certainly that is one part of functional training. However, there are many other parts. For example, the barbell has many functional applications to it. Just because your wrists are in a locked, fixed position on a barbell does not mean that it's not a functional piece of equipment. Compound movements, barbell movements, are significant and they do translate to sports performance. They do translate to your daily life. They do activate muscle groups. They do work through ranges of motion. And so when I see people really disregard the barbell as a piece of functional equipment, that's just not correct.
We need to stop being so binary and close-minded when we approach this idea of functional fitness. It's actually very difficult to not class something as functional, as long as there is specificity and overload attached to that exercise, as essentially everything that we do in the gym can increase functional capacity, again with a few caveats. And functional training as a concept is an umbrella term. It encompasses so much. It's a spectrum of exercises which meet specific goals, which increase functional capacity, again depending on you and your characteristics. We cannot just so generically brush functional fitness into a small box with a closed mind and then say this is functional and this is not. And the major problem I see is that movement training or exercises which envelop multiple planes of motion, multiple movements within that exercise are classed as functional, and then everything else which isn't that, which doesn't fit into that mold, is classed as non-functional. And the only people this benefits are those that are profiting from this. These people that can classify their form of training as functional, they can nicely package it and sell it to people as unique, sell their training courses and their programs because this is functional training. Yes, that is functional, but other exercises are too.
Unless you are disabled or you are a gymnast, how is doing handstand walks considered functional? If someone can please explain that to me, just comment it down below, seriously.
majority of the population simply getting stronger, regardless of the exercise employed, will enhance functional capacity. Ultimately, the functional transfer of an exercise exists on a continuum, with certain exercises having greater applicability than others based on individual goals and abilities. And just because a given exercise may provide greater functional transfer for a given person doesn't necessarily mean that the exercise is non-functional.
But what is functional strength, functional fitness, and functional movements are basically everyday life movements. These are movements based upon real-world situational biomechanics that usually involve a multi-planar or multi-joint movements, such as compound movements, but not necessarily, which place a demand on the body's core musculature. Now, some of these movements can be sport-specific and are only functional within that sport, although some crossover may be applied. It must be noted that if an exercise is not considered functional for yourself or for your needs, doesn't necessarily mean it's a bad exercise. In terms of functional strength, there are many definitions for this, and we've heard everything from your core used while moving, to the movement of the joints, to the very definition of functional movement. In sports science, we really don't take this as a thing.
Not only does that definition mean different things to different people, so does the definition of CrossFit.
CrossFit to me is just a way of life. It's not only a workout, but it's a lifestyle and it's a community.
Finishing is just as important as the first one.
It's this team atmosphere that ends up making you better as an individual. Camaraderie, that family that you end up building, and the energy that you get back from it yourself, that's CrossFit to me.
So that is everything the CrossFit Games isn't then.
Matt Valner conquers the chaos, and somebody get out there and tell this woman she's a rookie.
CrossFit to me is a fitness program where the reward for doing well is the ability to express your fitness in everyday life in as many different planes or as many different activities that you can possibly imagine.
When it comes to definitions, we mustn't confuse this with cross-training. Cross-training in sports and fitness is training for sport other than the athlete's usual sport in order to overcome a shortcoming with that sport to make that athlete or an individual better. To use an everyday example, that would be split training both cardio and weights within the same training session. So what is the CrossFit Games and why is it so different to standard CrossFit?
My life resume after this is going to be different. Don't leave anything to what if. Just go.
Matt Fraser's so motivational. Just anything he says, I reckon he could say, make me a sausage sandwich. And I'd be like, yes, I'm doing it.
The CrossFit Games is competitive fitness, and the CrossFit Games itself is the pinnacle within the calendar for competitive fitness. It is about finding the fittest man and woman on Earth.
CrossFit, that is what we call a hot potato of a topic. And so in this community, there will be people who do not like CrossFit. There will be people who love CrossFit. And there will be valid opinions on both sides. That is expected. Importantly, we have to separate the CrossFit Games from CrossFit. On the thumbnail, I show a CrossFit Games athlete, and then really just the average Joes who are taking part in CrossFit to develop their physical fitness. I think there are certainly valid critiques of certain aspects of CrossFit, but I also think there's some very good things that go on in certain CrossFit protocols. As there are negligent trainers in CrossFit spheres, of course there will be excellent, competent trainers. As there are people who do crazy stuff, there are people who approach CrossFit in a sensible manner.
CrossFit comes under a lot of fire and scrutiny for its principles, such as muscle confusion, and perceptually some of the crazy stuff that many people would consider unsafe, like expecting them to lift heavy ass weight, tired.
Now Valner's starting to struggle with one.
Defined as a work capacity across broad time and modal domains. At the CrossFit Games, we are testing fitness and individuals' work capacity across broad time and modal domains. The best way to maximize your fitness is through constantly varied functional movements executed at high intensity, which is the definition of CrossFit. Therefore, the best CrossFitter by our definition, is the fittest. This is basic knowledge for all affiliate owners and coaches who have been to a level one. It goes without saying that Pat hasn't attended a level one. When he feels ready, it will be free of charge.
That for a cut to 10 athletes, I think is unreasonable.
I think the second event was a cycle speed event with a new standard that had variable judging.
The aim is not necessarily to find the fittest person. The aim is to find the CrossFit Games champion. And if that's the aim, then that's the aim. And it could just be evolving.
Now guys, throughout this video, I will be making jokes and at times bashing CrossFit and functional fitness. Don't get me wrong. This does not necessarily mean I dislike CrossFitness or I disliked this movie. Find the actual spectacle, and it is a spectacle of CrossFit, very exciting to watch. This review should not be used to discredit CrossFit and those who partake who do it competitively. Far from it. The people who participate in it are absolute specimens of individuals, and what they do is pretty spectacular.
The Fittest is a hybrid documentary, observational, part participatory. However, it's not really an interactive documentary. In science, we would have known this as an ethnography from an emic perspective. The goal of the emic perspective is to gain full immersion, usually by those who are already affiliated within that culture, i.e. the Buttery Bros being CrossFitters themselves, interviewing and filming CrossFitters. This closeness to the subject and the relationships they had with the Buttery Bros means that we're able to gain an insight into the relationship and helps build the story, helps build the characters of those who are in contention to be the fittest on earth. In this highly cinematic documentary, there is also a plethora of expert interviews and interviews with the athletes themselves, also helping to build up their story. But I do wonder on the quality of the experts and the information they can provide. Some of them just seem to be CrossFit historical anoraks, or those provided by the sponsors. There was also meant to be a documentary series that went alongside the film. However, this was never released, presumably due to the cuts made within the media department and the ultimate confusion back at HQ.
30 grand for first place in that workout. That's silly. Guess who's blacking out?
This guy.
The Buttery Bros, both Herbert Cannon and Marston Sawyers, found themselves in a unique position, being redundant from CrossFit, but yet somehow still being clients of CrossFit. They ended up making their name as social media influencers.
Welcome to the biggest show on the planet.
I'd like to let you know that actually is the Olympics. Mind you, with me being British, I'm going to be biased. So I'm going to say 2012 Olympics was actually the best. To which in the top right, you'll be able to see the playlist I have made on how to gain Olympic gold medals.
Yep, that's right, guys. I'm about as confused as you are about Herb Cannon's statement.
We're here with so many fit people. Tell them about it.
Special guest Danny Bagley
and Scott Matheson. You might know him for flipping around on Instagram. Who else?
The fittest on earth, people. This is the CrossFit Games.
Somebody should make a movie about it.
I think we might.
About time. Roll the footage.
This is a review of the CrossFit Games 2019. And I will take a glottal stop, aka a pause between every word and sentence. Roll the footage.
Personally, I find their vlog YouTube footage rather grating, but to a certain individual, it is incredibly entertaining to watch, and they are very much personalities. The YouTube footage offers behind the scenes and unseen footage taken for the film, as well as giving us further unique glimpses into the lives of those who are associated with CrossFit. The behind the scenes footage also acts like a vlog.
There's a dog in here. What do you know about a dog?
That was incredible.
Matt Frazier, I'm coming for you.
Seriously guys, please don't give Dave Castro any ideas for next year's games. Now to these vlogs, we cannot deny there's an extremely highly commercial aspect to it. although definitely not overbearing.
Now, as someone whose only bit relating to CrossFit I've ever done is coaching Les Mills Grip, I'm probably not the one to know about how you would train for CrossFit, but what I do know and be able to understand is the critiquing of CrossFit relative in sports science and the exercise science theory, and being able to relate this to this particular film, The Fittest.
Shit. This is gonna be good.
In essence, what the CrossFit Games are and the events are effectively workouts, or WOD, which in CrossFit means workout of the day. They are testing for fitness.
This is more than just a competition of athletes. This is a competition of training methodologies. It is the sport of fitness.
Now, you could argue there are two understandings around what classifies being the fittest. In regards to competitive fitness, the first being that those who are truly the fittest should be able to adapt to the situation and be able to adapt on the fly, both mentally and physically.
So work capacity across broad time and modal domains. It's as complete as there ever has been a definition.
Fitness is your ability to perform. When we're talking about physical fitness, that means your ability to perform the given tasks using your body.
Fitness is not just in the gym, fitness is outside of the gym. It's life. Anytime you find yourself saying, damn it, I can't do that, you have a hole in your fitness.
I would explain fitness as an intersection of your basic ability to move other things, to move your body, and do those things in combination. It's that overlapping of ability that exists when you have the weightlifter and the runner and the gymnast. It's that part in the middle that intersects. And the bigger that part is, the more fit you are.
Without an empirical definition of fitness, all claims to be the fittest are meaningless.
You know, if you try and say you're trying to test for the fittest people on Earth, I think that test needs to be wide, it needs to be quantifiable, and it needs to be streamlined across the board for all athletes.
From short, from a 100 meter sprint to long, a marathon.
It also has to have known and unknown elements. So you're not just testing horsepower and pure output. In some respects, you're testing things that they've never tested before. Some of it's task accomplishment, some of it is speed through a certain task.
How can you recover with limited sleep, limited rest? You've got 4 days of competing. How can you recover and still perform well on the last day?
You have to be able to control when you push, how you handle discomfort. There's an element to physical fitness that has to live up here.
Likewise, if we don't know the events, if they adapt to it and able to overcome those barriers of a lack of specificity, then they are the fittest. And believe it or not, this actually is linked to a much older theory that connected those who created the modern Olympics. If you like, this also links into the definition of CrossFit. It depends how you interpret it, that it's constantly changing demands, and you being able to meet those changing demands. The other argument is that if an athlete cannot prepare, then they are not the fittest. By preparation and specificity, being able to do it consistently and consistently better than your opposition defines those who are the fit and those who are fitter than others at that event. Therefore, the fittest is the one who's able to prepare the best. Therefore, how can we define the fittest if the athlete isn't fit for that event? And the best thing about elite sport is that it's elite. Things that we can only dream to be able to do as an average individual or the average Joe. If they are doing subpar performances, how is this defining fitness? How is this elite performance if we are just promoting average? So let me know in the comments below which theory you particularly subscribe to. Theory 1 or Theory 2? Really, I should have 2 fingers up like that.
Now in sports science, we define fitness utilizing the sport principle of specificity, progression, overload, reversibility, and type. Another facet of the sport principle, it has to be individual and meet the individual needs of that athlete. There is no one size fits all.
One of these concepts is the concept of muscle confusion. That's doing multiple different types of exercise in order to confuse the muscles, in order to make them fit relative to all. Now, this ignores the principle of specificity, in that you do specific exercises and make sure you are fit relative to do that exercise. In theory, let's take the 100 meter sprint. The fittest athlete in the 100 meter sprint is the fastest athlete and the most powerful. Now, what CrossFit promotes, and we got to remember the demands of CrossFit, CrossFitness is to do fitness across modal and time demands. Therefore, the fittest CrossFitter, as Castro states here,
therefore, the best CrossFitter, by our definition, is the fittest. The fittest is also the best CrossFitter. So yes, we are testing for the best CrossFitter, and yes, that is also the fittest alive.
But yet again, are they really the fittest? You can never truly call yourself the fittest, hypothetically, if you are not specifically specified as the best in that event. Yet again, CrossFit is a multiple array of events in one. Think of it like the decathlon and heptathlon, multi-events in track and field athletics. The fittest athlete, or the best athlete, is the one who's able to meet all the demands of all the events. The fittest athletes are the ones who can throw the furthest, who can sprint the fastest, or run the fastest, and those who can jump higher and further than anyone else.
David Beckham. Now, Dave Castro, who's had more haircuts than David Beckham, it is his job to come up with the events for the CrossFit Games. He, however, is under direction from Greg Glassman how the CrossFit Games will be organised for that competition year. When we look at the sporting tests provided, did they actually test what we were looking for in order to define who is the fittest? Or was it the structure of the actual competition and the structure of the tests themselves hamper that, therefore leading to poor competition and poor event planning and programming?
2011 to 2018, it was like a big funnel where athletes started with the CrossFit Games Open. From there, the top athletes would qualify for one of nine regional level competitions. From that pool of athletes, 40 men and 40 women would then be invited to compete at the CrossFit Games to determine who was the fittest on earth. The new way looks like this. The top 20 men and women from the Open earn a spot. If you're a national champion in the Open, you earn a spot. You win a sanctional event, you earn a spot. In 2019, there was 15 sanctionals. Overall, 143 men and 117 women showed up at the CrossFit Games.
In terms of getting rid of regionals, replacing it with sanctionals, I absolutely love that. It gives the freedom to the athletes to choose where they want to compete, when they want to compete. It allows them to have some more freedom in their own life of determining out their competition season.
And the best guys and the right guys are going to get to the games.
Does this new format still find us the fittest man and fittest woman?
It was a perfect workout.
400, three legless rope climbs, seven snatches. 185 for the men, 130 for the women.
First heat of the first event, and it's some guys couldn't do a legless rope climb. And then if they did happen to get past that, they couldn't snatch 185.
For some of these athletes, although I'm really happy that they're there and they're able to compete on the world stage, I also feel really sorry for them. People like these people who couldn't even achieve what was being asked of them to be done. And that's probably the reason why in the women, for instance, only four finished. And in the men, only 44 was able to complete the first task.
I was talking to one girl and she was like, when would I ever be competing with Catherine and Annie and Sarah and myself? It's so to them, even though it might only be one event, it's really cool because they actually got to work out with us.
Cool. 800 meters, 66 shoulder to overhead, 100 and something feet handstand walk.
So, what were the events the competitors were asked to do if they got through the qualification and cutting process?
Every basically mile, they're going to increase the weight. So, 20, 30, 40, 50 pounds.
Event 5, Mary, 20 minutes.
as many reps as you can do. 5 handstand push-ups, 10 one-legged squats or pistols, and then finally, 15 pull-ups. One cut remains here as we get set to start event 6, a bracket-style event.
They brought in different like movements that had never been done at the CrossFit Games before. A dumbbell split snatch and a dumbbell clean and split jerk.
They'll step up to 195 pounds.
Straight ahead, swim around them, and back.
Tia Toomey and history, we are underway between her and Catherine Davidson.
Next element of the poor program we have to look at is the safety aspect.
But 215 pounds is the opening weight for the women. And
are you
is the
sure
platform.
That's not the men's opening weight? 215?
It's insane.
You could argue that the early elimination of the heaviest lifters to which we got an average from in order to come up with this opening weight meant that the women who partaken in it couldn't lift it.
Well, when he announced the weights, I'm like, that's like my one rep max, and I'm not going to be able to do that right now after a 3-day competition.
This is known as a Jagger effect, where you get an average from a range of data, but that average doesn't represent anything or anybody. Professional weightlifting and Olympic lifting, there are often weight categories. This is to recognize that the bigger you are, the likelihood the more you're going to lift. This doesn't necessarily take into account true strength. Relative pound for pound. Nonetheless, the lack of weight categories, it could be argued that those who are heavier will struggle on some of the other events. Therefore, as the competition goes on, this levels out the field.
Now, we are trying to define out and out pure strength, with the use as the clean as our means and methods of testing. However, if that's the case, why the decider for positions? Are we utilising strength endurance, not pure strength, as a means to define what strength is for those people to create a difference between position A and position B?
And then we get the safety aspect and element of it. When we start to see people tired trying to clean and lift like this, and oh, I'm wincing! Greatest chance of injury is when you're trying to lift tired. In CrossFit, there's a massive focus on getting as many reps in as you possibly can, in the training sense of it. When it comes to competition, you literally have to get that rep in order to get those points, to get those positions. This can lead to bad and dangerous form that can potentially lead to an injury, but
get him up there, girl!
The biggest cases of injuries in CrossFit are often from powerlifting and Olympic lifting events. Especially when these events are done when one is tired, trying to lift heavy weight. Irony is, with elite CrossFitters, they don't often get injured, often only having 2 to 3.5 injuries per 1,000 hours of exercise. For non-elites, it's somewhere between 0.26 and 0.78 injuries per 1,000 hours. And for some reason, females are more likely to get injured than males. The shoulders, spine and knee are the most commonly injured areas in CrossFit. However, in some CrossFit competitions, they always find stupid ways of getting their athletes potentially hurt.
Matt Fraser takes a nasty spill off of that thing, but he is okay, and Velner's off it as well.
I was excited by that one, but
if there was any controversial event, well, that had to be the sprint coupler, including a sled push. Like, I don't know what they think would not happen. Like, this had me screaming at the laptop. The CrossFit Games and CrossFit in general has had a massive problem when it comes to the sled events. For instance, many athletes will find themselves trudging when normally they would do well, and other athletes are practically lifting the sled and running upright.
With that technique right now.
Upright, she's carrying it.
Major problem to anyone with half a brain cell when looking at this event is that this event should in theory benefit those who are heavier, but the sled is so light that the heavier guys who need a bit more downforce are going to struggle as they cannot get the downforce needed to push the sled far.
We saw in the last heat 2/100ths of a second be the difference between first and second place.
Yeah, these bar muscle ups might as well not have even been there.
Olsen's off, he's back on the sled. Jamie Green is in the lead, but here comes Amanda Barnhart chewing up real estate in a hurry.
As soon as it was time to come back on the sled, my sled got stuck on the tape. It was getting stuck on the thing, and I'm like throwing the sled up and down, trying to make sure that it would move.
I hope everyone knows that I'm trying my hardest right now, but it probably looks like I am just stuffing around with this sled.
There was no running with the sled. It was trudging.
I was like, every single step you take has to be maximum.
It seemed like some of the big boys who should be able to push a tiny sled like that very well, like, we couldn't get it up to speed at all. You look like down the lane to your left and somebody's like running with it standing up, and you're like, what is that guy, what is he doing? Like, what is he doing that I'm not doing? The finish line, and people were just looking around like, what just happened?
What's happening with my legs? It kind of like hits you afterwards. It's one of those events. I could not stand at the end of that workout.
And I don't know what it is that was causing it this year, but it seemed that there were quite clearly certain lanes that were much faster.
Or to be precise, lane 2, 7, and 18.
And others, some people were pushing 200-pound sleds, and some people were out pushing a stroller.
There's no chance those sleds are the same. Okay. Lane made a difference. The way no sled moved, no f***ing way.
Dude, 3, 2, 1, go. I hit my sled, just went cool.
Same. Same. The way back, I caught on the tape. It
took
me like
too.
5 seconds.
I have never felt a 25-pound sled feel that heavy before. We had the same issue back in 2014 where it was like some of the lanes were in sunlight longer than others, and so some people were able to just do a straight up 100-meter sprint with their sled, and then there's others of us that it's like we're plowing a field.
When you had that argument in Carson on the grass, where there were some sections of grass that were wetter than others, and some sections that were greener than others, and some sections that were dried out and dead, I got the argument there. When you have that argument on artificial turf, on a completely level floor, on completely consistent sled, there is no different consistencies of surface or equipment.
He said, shortly after this event was over, I heard a lot of complaining by the athletes. I was surprised that very few athletes who performed poorly on this event held themselves accountable. It had to be something else that caused them to not place as high as they would have liked.
The sled. It was
okay, but that's not exactly the scientific evidence we have had, both from the 2014 CrossFit Games and also from the 2019 CrossFit Games.
That data those guys put together is junk. And here's why it's junk. That data would only be valid in this regard. If the event was a down, done, or a down and back of just one modality, the sled.
Okay.
What that data that they put together takes into zero account, it takes total time and finish, but there was a minute, almost a minute, not a minute, about 50 seconds of work in the middle of this event. You leave this sled, you have a transition period, you go to the bar and you do muscle ups, mm-hmm. and then you come back. Now, interestingly, those muscle ups were, even in programming, when I made this test, I said, this is a test of muscle ups. And if you look at the footage, that was a test of cycle speed and transition on the muscle up.
So what is this highly scientific peer-reviewed journal Dave Castro on about? What Science gave an in-depth analysis of the sled event at the 2019 CrossFit Games. Their analysis showed that 8, 9, and 16 were significantly slower than lane 8. They also demonstrated that this was not a bar muscle-up cycling workout. Sprint accounted for 31% of men and 52% of women's total variance in performance.
Was that some lanes, 2, 7, and 18, were much faster than the other ones. They were not only faster on average than the other lanes, but there was also not that much spread, meaning that all the athletes assigned to those lanes, independent of what heat you were in, were faster than average with not much difference in between them. The chances that lane 2 and lane 18 are by accident or randomly just faster than the others is less than 5%.
A quick interesting note about artificial turf, in that it offers less friction potentially to the foot sliding on the ground. Even though it's softer generally than natural grass, in some cases, players will often run faster of them. There is also more likelihood of getting soft tissue injuries on an artificial pitch. We can only speculate as to why this might have been the case. Was it because of water on the actual field? Was it because of the mist fans they use? Light on the artificial turf? Or was it just because of pure coincidence? So this leads us on to the equipment used at the CrossFit Games. More specifically, the ruck run.
So they're going to do a 6,000 meter ruck, but every basically mile, they're going to increase the weight. So 20, 30, 40, 50 pounds.
Go ruck guys approached us and said, hey, would you like to do a go ruck event at the games? I decided, well, I think we can do this for both genders. Instead of having a men's weight and a women's weight, let's just go with one weight. And I think that played out brilliantly.
Feel there were 10 pound bags all over that you had to just run up to, unzip your backpack, add a sandbag in, zip it back up and take off.
Now there was nothing overtly inherently dangerous unless you fell for a pothole in the field. However, one has to ask.
And I don't know if these rucks were meant to be used in that capacity with that amount of weight.
Like stinging, it's on fire.
My opinion, I know, but for a minute here, I thought we was testing fitness, not the mechanicality of the equipment, then affects performance. But then CrossFit has form with this kind of thing. In 2018, of which many people consider the best CrossFit games ever, there was massive problems with the bike malfunctions.
Patrick Felder has dropped a chain.
What a bunch of amateurs. The equipment wouldn't malfunction, just the competitors.
And instead of getting herself back on the bike, and that was a nasty tumble that she took right there, she says, to heck with this, I'm just going to run across the finish line.
Breaking and dislocating your wrist because your bike chain dropped brings new meaning to getting popped for using gear.
The top left and his pedal just pops off on his right foot.
I'm not too sure if this negative or positive publicity and marketing for the company involved. Now this event also highlighted the penalty system. Matt Fraser got a 60-second penalty for an event that took him around about 25 minutes to complete.
So it dropped me from 6th place to 17th place.
There was a lot of pressure on our team to go much harder, but I think this was appropriate for the actual situation.
Whereas Brooke Wells & Co. got a 10-second penalty for stepping on the line in a sprint event that lasts around 30 seconds to complete. The big debate on at the moment is whether the rules should be harder in terms of sanctions and penalties. However, in my honest opinion, I think the rules have to be more consistent regarding penalties relevant to the time of the event and the length of the event.
We can see that she pushes the bar up, gives herself a little bit of daylight under it, and then allows the bar to bounce off the shoulders. In my opinion, that should be a no rep.
Every judge has a particular standard that they want, and it's really hard sometimes to make sure that the field is even when it comes to judging and the movement standards.
You can't be flustered by getting a no rep. You just gotta keep cranking them out.
On the fittest, I believe. Now we're gonna test strength. As if strength wasn't a reasonable piece in the filtering process required to find the fittest up until that point. I mean, there was a significant criticism in that there wasn't a good strength component in the programming up until that point, which calls into question, legitimately in my opinion, whether or not the 10 athletes on the floor there are the 10 fittest athletes on earth.
Would have been better CrossFit Games overall if we would have kept 20 athletes at least through all of Saturday.
I would have certainly left it until the end of Saturday.
Maybe played out in my favor. If they change things next year, my suggestion would be to save the top 10 just for Sunday. Let a few more people ride it out for the rest of the week.
But there's a difference between a workout and a test, and specifically a test in the framework of this whole competition. And even at the games last year, if you look at all the whole of the test, it fits in pretty well. But the problem is that not everybody did everything.
The events we've had so far has been a fair test of fitness to narrow it down to 10. No.
And I wonder, when we look at the elimination process, and although highly necessary, and we look at the actual workouts themselves, I wonder if Dave Castro had actually got it right. This to me seemed like poor programming. Or was it poor programming? It could be argued that if you did not qualify to the Sunday, then there were clearly holes within your fitness.
Swap any event with any other event in that top six with some of the events that were at the end, you'd probably end up with a different top 10 as well. This is where I'm just going to go in with my opinion, and obviously, I mean, it means nothing. But if you looked at the games pre-2019, there were 40 athletes. All 40 athletes took these same tests throughout the whole weekend, of which then one was given the title Fittest on Earth. This year, you had six events up until the top 10, basically meaning that whereas before everyone would have got tested throughout the weekend, there was limited testing for some people. And we're used to seeing some specialists in some parts like weightlifting mess up the leaderboard for some people that were good at gymnastics, vice versa. Did we still get Matt Fraser on top and Tia on top? Yep.
Yep.
So was it a good test? Maybe. I think we should have had a top 20.
So they sled push down.
Yeah.
18 bar muscle ups for the men, 15 for the women, sled push back. It's like 2-3 minutes maybe.
Yeah, that's a race.
Gas pedal. Gas
pedal. We also can't predict the mindset of individuals. Cut after the sled pull, leading into Mary. This would highly affect the athlete's ability psychologically and therefore their potential ability to perform. Pressure affects athletes differently and everyone is individual. The way they react to the pressure and the pressure of the situation, pressure of the crowd, pressure from themselves is going to be highly individual to that particular athlete.
Jersey, everybody's looking at him and they're like, does Noah have what it takes? Does he have that drive, that fire to be able to best Fraser when he's trying to get his fourth win in a row?
Now, as mentioned before, I don't know necessarily much about CrossFit. But what I do know is sports science. And looking at this particular situation, I do have to wonder, did Olsen choke this? Choking is an extreme symptom of anxiety that occurs when athletes focus excessively on the execution of skills rather than allowing them to flow automatically without conscious effort. Sport commentators often use the word choking to describe a sharp decline in an athlete's performance. In reality, anxiety is not tangible. It simply involves a perceived imbalance between the skills you have and the demands of a particular sporting situation, and whether you can meet those demands. Noah Olsen had a marginal lead over the legend of the sport, Matt Fraser, off of the swim and paddle, leading into the last two events. Not familiar with the technical and tactical skills needed to do CrossFit.
And Noah Olsen has taken the lead.
However, with Matt Fraser only Olsen, just marginally behind Noah Olsen, this to me screamed a lack of peripheral vision.
As I stepped forward to the barbell, I heard everybody go crazy, and from my peripheral, I could kind of see that I was the only one on the barbell, so I was like, oh, sweet, they must be cheering for me.
A peripheral vision where the competition is. Yes, you've got to be in your lane, you've got to be in the zone, you can only focus upon what you can control and what you can do. But for when he did the snatches and tried to make him go broken to save energy, just seemed really bizarre to me, because this is the last event. You don't need to save your energy, just go for it, because Matt Fraser has to beat Noah Olsen in order to win. Noah Olsen can only become the fittest man on earth if he wins this event. Production wise, for a film with such a small budget, this was second to none. This was absolutely amazing. The art director had done really cool things, the art that makes it fit into the original scope of what CrossFit films were about, but ups it a little. It keeps within that aesthetic, as what we know, the music does exactly the same, as well as the over dramatization of it all, which acts to enhance the actual film, adding to it, even if this was a little bit cliche. And thusly, as a viewer, we get the idea that these people are really big deal. Speed of the film itself, going from slow motion to faster motion, helps to emphasize the ability of these athletes, as well as the talks with the athletes themselves, helps us to realize what they are thinking and what it takes to try and be the fittest man or woman on earth. All the extra stuff with the Buttery Bros in it was literally a vanity trip, and really didn't really need to be there inside the actual documentary. However, in the behind the scenes movie, it was necessary because it acted as a vlog. And I mean, the storytelling of the Buttery Bros themselves was utterly superb. But utilizing not only narrative to try and emphasize the story, but to try and utilize their filmmaking skills to help to also emphasize the story.
We do have to actually argue, was the documentary actually not unbiased? Yes, because of the media team being let go, the funding disappearing for media in particular, and especially for these documentary series they were going to write and create, the Buttery Bros had to go semi on their own. Go a little bit rogue, but they're not going to rock the boat. Yes, they gave us more information about how CrossFit is run. Usually the company itself is a bit of an anathema. Did we really truly get a truly independent documentary that showed us everything from an independent thought? Or is this just a fanboy on the Kool-Aid? Are these group of fanboys on the Kool-Aid not willing to rock the boat too much so that they can carry on and make money? Carry on promoting the tribalism, because if they rock the boat too much, it's going to be bad for business. It's going to potentially not make their documentaries sell, and thirdly, they will not get the contract for next year. Controversy sells. Too much controversy doesn't. CrossFit in the past liked controversy, but they don't want to make their business look really bad. They don't want to become, if you like, the heel company.
If you're seeking motivation for workout, then this offers this in the bucket loads and can be appreciated by all sport enthusiasts, which is the real premise of this CrossFit propaganda film. And it is propaganda. It is there to promote CrossFit. After saying that, you do not need to be a CrossFit enthusiast to appreciate and enjoy the film. It was highlighted that maybe more of the athletes in contention could have had more attention, rather than just the athletes who have been paid to be followed, such as Sarah Sigmund's daughter, the Claire Tiered Toomeys, and the Matt Frasers of the world. If you like, these are the CrossFit sweethearts. I know it's not taken as seriously, but they could have also focused upon the team events, not just on the individuals, and not just as on the top five sweethearts within those individual events.
Because too much bad publicity means decrease in affiliation and decrease in sales. Less customers as a result means less money. And they then can't necessarily promote their positive message on fitness.
If you like, this film is beautifully cinematic and highly visual, regardless of the financial setbacks. Although Marston, Sawyers and Herbert were there, they really, quite frankly, didn't need to be there. This film maybe did not have the same firepower as it did with previous years, but if it didn't, it wasn't that noticeable. You could really see the professionalism and experience of the filmmakers in process here, in order to get that down and dirty storytelling that we have become accustomed to with these kind of videos. Even if you have already seen the games and already know the results, there is still something for you here to watch. All in all, I give the documentary The Fittest a KSA score of 87.11.
My life resume after this is going to be different. Don't leave anything to what if. Just go.